speak to you about our research program where we try to develop MRI, non-invasive MRI, in humans into a tool that will allow us and give us information, at least some of the information histology can give us. Thus, the word in vivo histology. So I'd like to motivate that a bit further in the beginning, initially, and also explain to you maybe in more detail what we mean by that. And I was really delighted by the previous talk because I think it also set very nicely the scene for my presentation, in a sense, looking at networks, also mentioning Clarity, which is one of the techniques we are using. But in a sense, we are switching gear here a bit, looking at humans and really looking at a non-invasive technique. So why would we like to do that? Well, I think this is fairly obvious, and I think I'm bringing colds to Newcastle here at a neurology conference, but still it's good to remind ourselves of the fact that microstructure determines function to a very large degree, and as we all know, for example, there are these relationships between myelo and cytoarchitecture, for example, and the mediated functions like here motor cortex, somatosensory cortex. This has been exploited, for example, for cytoarchitectonic mapping of the brain. And in another way, actually function itself, for example, if we train subjects, if there's a pathology, can actually affect the microstructure, and even subtle changes in microstructure can lead to debilitating diseases, as you know. So to really understand that circle between structure, function, at the microstructure level and mesoscopic level, what we really would like to have is a tool we can apply in humans, non-invasively. And that's exactly the motivation here that drives our research, our long-term research program. Maybe to kind of reiterate that in other words is to look at spatial scales. I find that really useful and very important to understand that concept. So when you look nowadays at the situation of MRI scanning, we probably more or less we could say, well, we look at macroscopic structures in the range of millimeters, maybe centimeters. We can look at the entire brain. That's great. With the latest kind of hardware technology we have, like ultra-high-field MRI, we can even push this down into the range of mesoscopic structures. So we talk about here layers, columns, stripes in the cortex, for example, which range in the area of about 100 micrometers to maybe 400 or 500 micrometers, a millimeter max. But if we really want to go into the microstructure and microscale, that means, for example, looking at this very detailed substructures in the cortex of axons in there. I mean, we talk about structures in the micrometer range now, 1 micrometer. If you go from the macro scale to the micro scale, that's kind of 7 orders of magnitude in terms of spatial scale. That's a huge step. That would be something along the lines, imagine Berlin as a city, the extent of Berlin, and you would like to measure every screw and nail that holds together the houses in Berlin and the furniture. That would be the axon. So conceptually, we have a big challenge, but we also obviously have technically a big challenge. With MRI, you will never get the voxel resolution in vivo of 1 micrometer. But what we can do, we can use the right biophysical models to exploit information in the MRI signal that allows us to build models that tell us something about the aggregate content within a voxel. So something like, for example, the average axonal diameter in a voxel. So we get, we can go into that microscale by applying the right models. The challenges to get there, I think, are pretty obvious. I mean, one is resolution. At the moment, we are here with 1 millimeter resolution, roughly. We'd like to get there, similar to histology. So at least we need resolution of maybe 200 to 400 micrometers. But since the signal-to-noise in MRI depends on the voxel volume, this means going from 1 millimeter to 200 micrometers means a hit of over 100 in signal-to-noise ratio. This is a big challenge. Imagine also in terms of artifacts, try not to move by 200 micrometers. Impossible. So this really needs to be addressed. What is maybe less obvious is the issue of specificity. MRI has a great exquisite soft tissue contrast, as you all know. But there are times where you might see structures and contrast that is identical, but the underlying microstructure is completely different. So we talk about specificity, and in a similar way, we talk about standardization that comes with that. So these are really, in my opinion, the big challenges we need to address there in our lab, but also in the community, I should say that. Now, why do we think is this at all possible? Well, this is trying to schematically argue for that. Here's so-called multi-parameter mapping. This is acquiring MR images with very different contrasts and quantifying them. When you look at them, they look very different because they are sensitive to different aspects of the underlying microstructure. Here, for example, R2-star maps are sensitive to iron. So you see the basal ganglia with a higher iron concentration quite nicely. You have magnetization transfer maps and T1 or 1 over T1 maps that show myelination quite nicely, for example. And the other map here, proton density, does exactly what it says. It shows water, the proton density. So here the ventricles would pop up. So already with these kind of images, you have a correlate with the underlying microstructure. Now we can ask ourselves, why is that so? And this is a really an extremely simplified version of what's going on, but still I'd like to use that for the motivation here. When you look at, for example, intracortical neuronal structures, you have neurons, you have oligodendrocytes, and when you zoom in and you ask yourself what's in there, then you can see, for example, that in the oligodendrocytes, obviously, they build the myelin sheath around the axons. The myelin sheaths themselves, for example, limit and restrict diffusion, so they affect a diffusion phenomenon. The somata of the oligodendrocytes contain quite a lot of iron. And obviously, there's everywhere water. So that's kind of a very simplified environment here now for the time being. Now, what is really special about MRI is, in principle, what you are measuring signal from protons, and mostly from protons within water. Now, you would ask, why do they depend on that? And that's exactly the kind of the main feature, important feature of MRI, that those water molecules, they kind of diffuse in that environment, they kind of sense their environment. So it really depends where the water sits. So they can actually indirectly tell us something about iron concentration. They cannot tell us something about macromolecules in myelin. And that's why it's possible to actually see contrasts of, for example, white matter versus gray matter. And keep in mind, I mean, here we talk about molecular resolution now, in a sense. So we are sensitive to processes that happen at that level, even though we might not strictly be able to resolve them in terms of the effective voxel size, but we are sensitive to it. And that's what we are exploiting by building now the right biophysical models that take us from standard weighted images you might be familiar from clinical imaging to quantitative imaging, so standardized imaging, and then to neurobiologically relevant metrics, such as, for example, fiber densities or iron concentration connectivities. So, and this step up here, that's really the crucial one, that's the very difficult and challenging one for us, but I will show you some examples where we have made progress. So now let me come to brain connectivity and the way how we use these techniques to start looking at brain connectivity in a different way you might be used to from, let's say, the general literature of MRI. So in the general literature of MRI, what people typically do, they do some kind of diffusion-weighted tractography, and they look at these major fiber bundles. And then they might transform those, for example, into topologies, into net, and induce them for network analysis in health and disease. They might also use some functional markers as well, for example. But what we are actually interested in, we would like to zoom in further and look at particular fibers such as, for example, here those U fibers connecting adjacent gyri. So really short-range connectivity, or even shorter range, we would like to look at connectivity within the cortex. So we talk about, for example, myeloarchitecture of the cortex we'd like to study. And the reason for that is, there are many arguments for it, but I think the kind of most blunt one, the simple one is here really when you look at the number of connectivities, cortical connectivities, and you just try to count them. You see that the great, absolute, overwhelming majority are actually the short fibers here, below 3 millimeters. And so for me, this is a very strong motivation to build techniques that will give us access to those in vivo. And the first one I'd like to present to you is what I briefly adapt here, cortical myelin mapping. So here the basic idea is, as we know, there's a particular myeloarchitecture in the cortex, and it varies across the cortex. So we can, for example, distinguish brain areas based on their myeloarchitecture. And what we started and set out here to do, this is still from my time working in London, we acquired 800 micrometer high-resolution data at 3 tesla here, and segmented out the cortical ribbon here, that cortical sheet. So in a sense, you can imagine what we did is just take the cortex, throw away the rest of the brain, the rest of the information. And what you can do then, you can interrogate your data set and ask, what is the measured, in this case, R1 value? So that's kind of related to the longitudinal relaxation rate. In the cortex, in the middle of the cortex, when you think about the profile. And if R1 is a good myelin marker, as I've suggested in one of the previous slides, then actually this should tell us something about the myeloarchitecture. Just a point estimate, not really showing us nice profiles, but give us the average myelination of the cortex at that point. That's exactly what we have done. Here you can see an inflated version of the MRI scan, so you only see the cortex, and the R1 values, which we interpret as a myelin marker, are here the colored, colored or highlighted areas, and whatever is bright means high R1 values, whatever is darker or not colored at all means low R1 values, and high R1 we would interpret as high myelination in the cortex. And when you look at it, what pops out are all the primary sensory motor areas, for example, you also have primary visual cortex, and also AREMT, which we know are highly myelinated. And when you compare this to ex vivo measurements here, for example, by Flexig, who worked in Leipzig in the 1920s and described the early myelinating areas, which are also typically the highly myelinated areas, I think there's a striking similarity. But again, it's a trivial point, but I think a really important point to make. Obviously, this subject is dead or was dead. Those are alive. And that makes a huge difference for the type of studies you can do. And for example, what we did in collaboration with Marty Cirino in London, we did functional MRI in the same subjects. And we could define functional areas like the primary visual cortex here based on fMRI. And we could compare this to those R1 myelin maps. And you can see, for example, that the borders functionally defined here lie very nicely on top of the borders you would define based on the R1 myelin marker. So this gave additional credibility to the idea that the R1 maps are actually indicative of myelination within the cortex. And I think what it also tells you is this is an example of doing structure-function relationship studies that are zooming in with MRI into features that are really microstructure, like the myelination here in the cortex. So first step towards doing these studies. Now we have moved on to 7T here in Leipzig. 7T offers much higher SNR than 3T, as you probably know. And you can zoom in even further. Now we have 400 micrometer resolution R1 maps. I will just run through them here. And I hope you can appreciate that the white matter is not a homogeneous substance here anymore. You can you can actually see lots of subtle features. If you look at this area here, you will see in the cortex kind of white ribbon, which is actually the line of Chenari, the tree of Chenari. And basically, you can start seeing layers and substructures in the cortex. And I'd like to give you one example here. Again, that's the stria of Chenari. That's the highly myelinated area in the primary visual cortex, as you would expect. And here you can see that quite nicely. You can see the white ribbon, that's actually within the cortex. That's the stria of Chenari. And in a profile, you can nicely see this going from white matter, the myelination reduces, then it goes up in the line of Chenari and goes down again. So exactly what you would expect from anatomy. And we are getting there with MRI now, with a non-invasive technique. We only get there, obviously, by improving the technology further. And one important step is artifact reduction, and in particular, motion artifacts. This is an image acquired with a special optical motion tracking system that prospectively corrects for motion during the scan. And this is the original image without using that. And you can see how much crisper it becomes. And it just requires a little marker attached to the subject's head and a camera in the scanner to do that. And it can even track activities such as respiration, as you can see here, and even the cardiac pulsation. Here, these little peaks are head motion related to cardiac pulsation. And when you look at the extent of that motion, that's really relevant. We talk about here motion in the range of 200 micrometers, so very close to the Voxer sizes we actually use. So we need to deal with motion. That's crucial. I was talking about different contrasts. The one contrast I've showed you for the cortical myelin mapping was R1, the longitudinal relaxation rate, as a myelin marker. Now I'm going to talk about diffusion. So I mentioned to you that diffusion can actually hinder and restrict, that microstructure can hinder and restrict diffusion. So here what we were trying to do is trying to get markers for intracortical fiber volume fractions, or fiber densities, you could say. In particular, what we were interested in are the radial fibers, you could also say the efferent and afferent fibers into the cortex, and the tangential fibers being the collateral fibers. So that's the neuroscientific relevance here. When you look at a single fiber, one model to model that is to say, well, we have the situation that there are myelin sheaths which restrict the diffusion, so I have primarily diffusion along the fiber and not orthogonal to it. And then I have outside the fibers, I have relatively free diffusion. So this is kind of a toy model or a simplistic model of diffusion in the cortex. But it's important to build it because it can tell you how to interpret the MRI data, the diffusion-weighted MRI data, which you probably know from imaging in stroke. But you can extend that into really quantitative modeling and estimations of microstructure. Here, what Luke Edwards did in my group, he simply modeled that by those radial fibers and also the tangential fibers by a disc-like structure. Because if you think about it, along this axis, you would have sticks, but in the orthogonal direction, they point in all directions. We have a three-dimensional structure, so it becomes a disc. He set up the equations for that and fitted these equations to postmortem data, also of the visual cortex. And in addition, to constrain the model and make this more feasible, he used the information from the macroscopic anatomy that he knows which ones are actually the radial fibers and which ones are the tangential fibers, tangential orientation, because that's defined by how the cortex is convoluted and gyrified at that point. So use that in addition. And then interesting what he found here, he found a little, it's not a fantastic peak, but there's a little peak here in the tangential fibers, and that's in line with the increased amount of fibers in the line of Chenari again, which I talked about previously. And when you look at the radial fibers, you find exactly what you would expect, that the amount of fibers increases when you go from the pile surface to the gray-white matter boundary. And this is really the first step to do intracortical fiber density, get intracortical fiber density estimates, but it's still ex vivo with very high resolution here, 200 micrometer resolution. Of course, it's a model. As you know, models, you always have to test clearly construct validity of the models as well. And that means you need, for example, some kind of reference data you can compare them against. And that's the reason why we are working on this particular technique, actually invented by the previous speaker, Clarity, to clear tissue. As you can see here, it removes the lipids, it becomes clear, you can look through it. Incidentally, that's from a publication from a long time ago by Spalteholz, who developed one of the first clearing techniques about 100 years ago. So what you can do, you clear it, and then you have much better access with microscopy. And you can stain, for example, for myelin. You can get out information where the myelinated fibers are in the cortex and in what direction they point. I'll show you a movie here. You can run through that. And that gives you now a three-dimensional volume and information about where the fibers are, in what direction they point, and what fiber densities you have. And so this is exactly the tool we need to validate the previous model that predicts fiber densities. And here, again, spatial scales, what we talk about here, were step sizes of 2 to 4 micrometers, roughly. So with very high resolution, giving us ground truth information. Now, all these examples about the fiber densities I've shown to you, they were based on post-mortem measurements, obviously also the Clarity data. Now, the question is, how do you get this back into the in vivo case? That's a huge challenge, because in particular, diffusion imaging offers very low signal-to-noise and very low spatial resolution if you compare it to other acquisition techniques. So one of the approaches we pursue here is using the latest technology in terms of MRI scanners, so-called connectome MRI system, which has very strong gradients, so factor 5 to 10 higher amplitudes than standard conventional clinical scanners. And you can think about it in a way that it's, in terms of the gradient system, it's not a single scanner, but it's more or less like 4 scanners. So we add 4 gradient calls for each direction on top of each other to achieve these high gradients. Now we would say, okay, this is a huge engineering effort. What is in it for us? Well, I hope this kind of image over here convinces you of the benefits of such a system. This is a diffusion MRI image acquired with a standard conventional parameter set. You can hardly see and make out any structure here. Signal to noise is very poor. If you do the same imaging but with a higher with this connectome gradient set, you have an immense signal to noise boost. I mean, we talk about factor 3 in terms of SNR. And as we are in MRI typically signal to noise limited, so we can't increase the resolution because the signal-to-noise is too low. It means improving the signal-to-noise means we can go to higher resolution. And this is from the group in Boston, some recent data, where they now acquired diffusion data with 660 micrometer resolution. And that means we're kind of getting in the domain that at least we can maybe distinguish the top layers from the mid layers from the bottom layer or deeper layers in the cortex. And here you can see, for example, diffusion tensor imaging and the main direction of those tensors in the cortex. And you can nicely see how they are aligned with the radial direction in the cortex, as you would expect it, for example. So we believe this will be a big step forward, and we're excited about using this newly commissioned system, which we just received in January this year. Now, the last topic I would like to cover is by zooming out a little bit further and looking not inside the cortex anymore, but just underneath it. We are looking at the superficial white matter, and we are looking at the so-called U fibers connecting adjacent gyri through the superficial white matter. Again, short-range connectivity we are interested in. They are notoriously difficult to image. Diffusion-weighted imaging is really difficult because you have crossing fibers, for example, here going from left to right, and then the afferent fibers going from top to bottom. So crossing fibers are really difficult for us. It's a thin structure, 0.5 millimeter, so we need very high spatial resolution. And also, there are lots of complexities understanding the contrast. So we were looking for other techniques to image the superficial white matter, other techniques than diffusion imaging. Evgenia Kirilina in my group, she came up with the idea to look at susceptibility-weighted imaging and also anything that is basically gradient echo-related contrast, like the R2-star. R2-star is 1 divided by T2-star, which you might be more familiar with. If you zoom in, what you can see is here, we have highlighted the cortex in red for you. You can see very nicely these hyper-intense bands, which show an increase in susceptibility, which indicates it should be an increase in iron there, most likely. So we thought maybe iron is a good marker for superficial white matter, U-fibers, and potentially U-fiber density. But that's a poor speculation at this point. So you want to dig deeper and understand that better. And one way to dig deeper is go postmortem again. Do mass spectroscopy imaging, which gives you elemental and quantitative information about the iron distribution. And here, you can see the same hyperintense stripe increase in iron, where you see the increase in the signal in the MR images. But you don't see that increase, for example, in the myelin volume fraction. So we have an indication that actually what's happening here is this looks like deep white matter, except for there's more iron in there. And why would that be? Well, you bring out the big guns. So here, proton-induced X-ray emission, you need a linear accelerator, which we have access to in the Department of Physics in Leipzig. And that gives you cellular resolution maps of iron distribution. Now you can actually see that iron sits, for example, in the somata of the oligodendrocytes, and what we think also in the myelin sheath. So you understand now the microstructural geometry of iron. How does this help you? Well, you can already here guess that probably, because it's related to the number of somata of oligodendrocytes, probably is related to the number of fibers, and in particular, myelinated fibers, obviously. And you can even use that for modeling. This is a busy slide, but what you should take away from that is what Evgenia did. She took those iron maps, histology, and predicted how the MRI signal should look like, how the R2 star values should be like. And this is a model that has no free parameters, no fit here. And when you look at what is predicted, you're very close to the experiment in MRI. And this is really important because now we have the forward model. And when we have the forward model, we might be able to invert that and actually get from MRI information about microscopic geometry of iron distributions. Going back into the in vivo case, what might you be able to do with it? Well, we had one interesting observation. We can't really explain at this point, but I think I would appreciate a lot if anybody commented. But what you can see is kind of wherever you have intracortical myelination that is very, very high, you have relatively little kind of superficial white matter, and vice versa. So there seems to be kind of an anti-correlation, and we are investigating that further at the moment. So I'd like to wrap up here. I mean, I think the first point is quite obvious. MRI is a really nice tool in terms of having non-invasive technique, giving us access to the brain microstructure. And maybe that's a less known fact, but I think really equally important is that it gives us information about the microstructure that is even smaller than the voxel sizes we have. And that's exactly what we exploit. I hope you will take that away from the presentation. The potential, I think, is huge to transform here how we look at neuroimaging in terms of looking at structure and function and their relationships, potentially early biomarkers, obviously, being able to look at such small structures, and doing population studies on microstructure, I think, is very exciting as well. The remaining challenges are huge. This is a long-term research program, so simply the spatial resolution, specificity, and precision of the techniques needs to be improved even further. We need to improve our understanding what's happening in terms of the relationship between microstructure and contrast. And what I haven't really talked about is that obviously these data sets we generate are huge. The 400 micrometer data set is about 400 gigabytes of raw data you need to process. So we also need to talk about, or we need to address, image processing challenges. And last but not least is also validating all these techniques. And that means we need to push the current histology techniques, but we also need to come up with really smart experiments to do in vivo validation. If you are interested in that, you can also read more about that in German, actually, in a special issue that came out recently in Der Nervenarzt, or in the publications I mentioned previously. At this point, I would like to thank my group, especially the investigators doing the studies I've shown and leading on the studies I've shown to you, and the many collaborators we have, which are essential to get such multidisciplinary experiments off the ground and make it a success. And I would like to thank you for your attention.